This video is not me trying to preach atheism, whatever that means. Your beliefs are your own. I'm nobody to influence that. What I am going to do is take a look at what makes an idea scientific or not, and what makes the idea of God unscientific. Let's begin. Hi, my name is Pranav and you're watching scienceisdope. This video is not going to be about any specific religion because all religions have some commonalities in their idea of God, the same ones that make them unscientific. But to see what those are, we have to first understand what makes an idea scientific in the first place. So let's do that by looking at the scientific method. I've gone over this a bit previously. You can take a look at my channel. There's an entire playlist on the scientific method. We're going to start by looking at how we know if something is true or false. This leaf is green. You observe it to be true, don't you? It's that simple. When you observe something to be true with one of your senses, you know it's true. Even when you make some interpretations to reach that final truth, it has to be validated by some observation. That's how reality works. When you claim something to be true, when it's not validated by observation, aka evidence, then you're not talking about reality. You're just speculating. You don't know there's something to be true, you believe this to be true. Call it spiritual or extrasensory or third eye sensing or whatever, basically you're just speculating. Observations, unfortunately, are not always straightforward and simple, like a leaf being green. Sometimes they involve measurements which can lead to errors, which can lead you to wrong conclusions. But let's not talk about the misinterpretation of observations, and let's not talk about the biases and fallacies which lead you to wrong conclusions. I'll do that in a separate video, but for this video, let's assume all observations are simple and straightforward. So how do you gather knowledge about the world? You just have to start noting down your observations, the things that are true. Like, this watch is showing a time of 3 p.m. That bus is faster than that man. The sun rises in the east. The moon is up in the sky today. But if you start doing this, you'll quickly realize why no one really does this. There are an infinite number of observations that you can make, and you don't have all the time in the world to know them all down, even if you were immortal. Okay, so now what do we do? You know what? While making those observations, I noticed there were a bunch of patterns. Like, this leaf is green, and this leaf is green, and this leaf is green. Every single leaf I've seen is green. That gives me an idea. Instead of noting down each individual observation I've seen, why don't I note down these patterns? There are far fewer of those, right? And these patterns will tell me what those individual observations are. Okay, so all leaves are green, all clouds are white, all things fall to the ground when dropped, all stars shine at night. By noting down these general statements, now we're getting somewhere. We're gathering some knowledge about the world. I know there are some of you already typing in the comments, "Bro, what are you saying? There are dry leaves which are not green." I know. Even the other general statements I said have some flaws in them that you can point out. Relax, I'm getting to all that. Let's go step by step. We have with us a bunch of general patterns that everything seems to follow. This much we've seen. But don't high-five yourself just yet, because we're not the first ones to figure it out. People have been noticing such patterns forever, and so we already have statements like these. We can think of most of general statements from which we can figure out these singular observations. Great, that makes our work easy. We just have to start using these general statements that people have already noted. But wait, before you start accepting these statements, what if some of these statements are wrong? I mean, what if someone made a mistake while observing these patterns, and so before you accept them, you want to somehow figure out if they're true or false? What if you could test them? Okay, take this statement. How do you test this? Let's make observations. A river that's flowing into the sea tells you nothing, because the statement is about all rivers, and so one observation can't tell you if it's true. But one observation can tell you if it's false, right? You just have to find one river that doesn't flow into the sea, and you immediately know that the statement is false. Basically, if you take a general statement, you don't have a truth condition, you have a falsity condition. What I mean by these conditions is a single observation that can tell you if the idea is true or false. Let's try it again with this statement. All swans are white. Observing a white swan tells you nothing about the statement, but a black swan tells you that the statement is false. There is no truth condition, but there is a falsity condition, and to find that, you just have to find a counterexample for this general statement. This is how you test all general statements, not by trying to confirm them, but by trying to falsify them. Why? Because they don't have a truth condition, they only have a falsity condition. So what have we learned? Singular statements can be true or false, and we can learn this through observation, aka evidence. General statements can be tested by attempting to falsify it. Introducing the scientific method. You first observe a green leaf. From this, you draw a general statement. Now you have to test it. Try to falsify it. You have to try and find a leaf that's not green. Bingo, congrats, you have falsified the general statement. Now what do? You try and modify the general statement you had to account for this observation. How about all fresh leaves are green? Seems okay. Now you test this. Nope, that's green. Nope, that's green. Nope, that's green. You keep testing, but you haven't been able to find a non-green leaf. So what's your conclusion? There may be non-green leaves out there, but I've tested this many times and I haven't found any. And each time I've tested this and failed to falsify it, my confidence in the statement I have has gone up. I'm now so confident in this idea that I'm gonna rely upon it to make predictions of what I'm gonna observe. Every time I observe a leaf, even without looking at it, I know that it's gonna be green. All the while keeping in mind that I may be wrong one day, but hey, that's just part of the process. Because now I just go back and modify the original statement so that it now accounts for everything I've observed so far. And then we start testing it again. How? We try to falsify. And so on and so forth. This is the scientific method. Of course, I've used highly simplified examples. It's far more nuanced and more complex than this, but this is the basic process of science. Scientists try to make very general statements from what they observe, and then they try and make it even more general by using math. For example, I can say that everything falls down. I can make it even more general by saying the Earth pulls everything towards its center with an acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared. And still more general by saying all things in the universe attract each other with a force F equals GMM by R squared. And the Earth pulling everything down is just a consequence of this. You must be thinking, man, a science this easy? There has to be a catch. Unfortunately, there is. Imagine someone famous said, "We are all in a simulation." He gets cheers from the audience, fanboys start repeating every word he said, and everyone goes, "Wow." But not you. You, having learned all your science, decide to test it. How do? Try to falsify it with a counterexample. But what's a counterexample for the statement? You can't think of any. What would you be able to observe if this statement were untrue? Everything around you would still look the same, right? No matter what you observe, it always agrees with the statement. Can you think of a counterexample, something that this statement would rule out? Let me know in the comments, because I can't. So what does this mean now? This is a general statement, so there's no truth condition to begin with. And now you can see it can't be shown to be false. There is no falsity condition, so what's there left to test? There's nothing you can observe that'll tell you anything about the statement. The statement is now untestable, and if you have a general statement, just by having no falsity condition, that is, by being unfalsifiable, they automatically become untestable. And unfalsifiability, my friends, is a problem. Remember we had a bunch of general statements earlier? Let's see if any of them are unfalsifiable. Remember, all a statement has to do is rule out a possibility and it automatically becomes falsifiable. And testing is basically trying to find an observation that the statement rules out. So by that logic, we can figure out which statements are falsifiable and which are not. Have we noticed a problem with unfalsifiability yet? Okay, let's take this first statement. All swans are white. It predicts something about what we can observe in the world, a white swan. But more importantly, it also rules out all these possibilities. If the statement is true, then you can only observe white swans. That is, it has a certain predictive power. Now take all diseases can be cured by eating an apple. What does this statement rule out? If we see a sick person get better by eating an apple, that agrees with the statement. If he doesn't, hey, that still agrees with the statement. In fact, no matter what happens, it can be explained using the statement after the fact. It doesn't rule anything out, and so it doesn't predict what will happen beforehand. In other words, unfalsifiable statements have no predictive power. They only have explanatory power. Now, science is meant to reliably predict things. That's where all scientific advancements come from. Always, when you burn fossil fuels in an engine, you'll be able to rotate something. Next thing you know, cars are born. Always, when you rotate a coil wire near a magnet, you'll be able to produce electricity. And next thing you know, our homes have power. In fact, statements that can't be reliably used to make predictions this way are useless in science. In other words, unfalsifiable statements are unscientific. Falsifiability of a statement, that is, does it have a falsity condition that you can test for? That is the criterion that must be satisfied for a statement to be scientific. Anything that doesn't satisfy this condition and claims itself to be scientific is a pseudoscience. Take any idea that's scientific. Einstein's relativity, quantum mechanics, Newton's laws of motion, the theory of evolution, these are all falsifiable. In fact, anything mathematical is automatically falsifiable because it rules things out. And things like the law of karma, astrology, almost anything that comes under spirituality, these are all unscientific because they are unfalsifiable. They rule nothing out. You might have guessed where I'm going with this. Imagine I claimed that there was a teapot somewhere in orbit around the sun. How did it get there? We don't care. But how do you test this? Just find the teapot. Pretty simple, right? There is a truth condition, but how do you find it? You can try looking through a telescope, but even a normal sized teapot would look way too tiny to be seen by a telescope. I mean, if even Jupiter looks tiny through a telescope, how are we gonna find a teapot? Let's say you sent a spacecraft to try and find it. You might still not be able to. So this truth condition looks pretty hazy. But what about the falsity condition? What would you be able to observe if the statement were false? I mean, everything you see in the solar system would still remain the same whether or not the teapot is there. And even if you send a spacecraft to try and find it and you don't find it, that doesn't mean it's not there, right? It could have been somewhere else and not the place where you were looking for it. Basically, there is no falsity condition. The idea that there is a teapot in orbit around the sun is unfalsifiable. The statement God exists is very similar in many respects. Let's look at its truth and falsity conditions. The idea of God itself is very vague. If you were to look for God, you don't really know what you're looking for. And depending on your specific religion, there are ideas like God can't be seen or perceived using any human senses. So there goes the truth condition. And what about the falsity condition? If the statement were untrue, what would you be able to find? Not being able to find God doesn't mean God's not there, right? And can you tell me anything that might be different if the statement were untrue? Don't give me something like, there wouldn't be anything if God didn't create it. Because now you're starting with an assumption that God created everything. You're sneaking in your conclusion with your premises. There is nothing that you'd be able to observe if the statement were false. There is no falsity condition. The idea of God is unfalsifiable and therefore unscientific. There are more ideas like this. Unicorns exist, aliens exist, karma exists, the flying spaghetti monster exists. Some of them have truth conditions, but none have ever been found, but they're all unfalsifiable. I'll give you more. The idea that you can pray and God will grant your prayers is unfalsifiable. Because if what you prayed for happened or didn't happen, neither of them falsified that initial statement. Same thing when we hear, God only helps those who help themselves. That's unfalsifiable. Because let's say you were successful. Hey, God help you. But if you were unsuccessful, hey, God didn't help you because you didn't work hard enough. The same way God works in mysterious ways is unfalsifiable. Tell me how in the comments. This is the incompatibility of the idea of God and science. And when you learn science and become a scientist, when you start thinking in terms of evidence, most people stop believing in God. Richard Dawkins, Neil deGrasse Tyson, Lawrence Krauss, Niels Bohr, Richard Feynman, Subramaniam Chandrasekhar, Stephen Hawking, Steven Pinker, Bertrand Russell, Meghnad Saha, Carl Sagan, they are all open atheists. And there are still more who are not theists in the traditional sense. Albert Einstein, for example, was a deist, and C.V. Raman was agnostic. There are still more that are closeted atheists. They've not publicly come out. They're not open about the fact that they're atheists because of familial or community obligations, and they're just silent bystanders to religious practices going on around them. But there are scientists who strongly believe in God still. In fact, I've done a video where scientists are sitting around the God-man Sri Sri Ravi Shankar and asking him sincere questions about God. There are Nobel Prize winners who endorse young earth creationism who are evolution deniers. So what about them? Why do they find it easier to go with their beliefs rather than with evidence? Why do people have such a strong belief in the first place? Imagine two cavemen 100,000 years ago. They both hear rustling in the bushes. One of them thinks it's a tiger and wants to run away. The other one thinks it's probably nothing, maybe the wind, and wants to check it out. Who do you think has a better chance of survival? The first guy. It doesn't matter who was right this time. The one who has a tendency to think that something caused what happened has a better chance of escaping something dangerous and hence survive and have children. And it's his descendants that are still alive today. We are his descendants. So we have that same tendency that he has. Whenever we see something happen that we can't explain, we have a tendency to assign the cause of that something to an agent. When we see the beauty of life and nature and everything the world has to offer, and when everything seems inexplicable, we tend to think that some agent that has supernatural intelligence and consciousness designed and created it. That sort of makes perfect sense to us, even if there's no evidence for it. And even if today we have perfectly natural explanations for almost everything we see. Not gonna get into all of these in this video, but maybe a future video. The second reason is the things we are made to believe as children. Children aren't born knowing all these things. Rather, they are taught to pray, taught to worship God, told stories about God, depending on the family or culture or religion that they're born into. And our parents weren't lying to us, they just didn't know any better. What's more, once a child grows up with these strong beliefs, everything he or she sees and understands is from this point of view. These beliefs form the base on top of which most acts of knowledge and new beliefs are built. And so if anyone tries to change these core beliefs, then the mind has a subconscious tendency to resist that change in belief. Because you get rid of this base and the whole stack will come tumbling down. When someone comes with strong arguments against our beliefs, our tendency is to double down on what we already believe rather than look at the evidence. So it's not wrong or stupid on a person's part to believe in God. What's wrong, in my opinion, is if you use your influence to get thousands and millions of people to believe what you do when you have no evidence, when there's evidence against you. What's wrong is if you refuse to look at the evidence when it's presented to you, and what's wrong is if you start lying to yourself. Belief in God alone, however, is only natural, especially if the family or the environment they grew up in is extremely religious. And because of this, there are still scientists who closely hold on to their religious beliefs. There are Nobel Prize winners who are young earth creationists. There are scientists who believe in the superiority of their scriptures. And of course, medical doctors who are extremely religious. And when it comes to making a choice between their religious beliefs and scientific evidence, they would much rather choose the former. Now, that's a video you might find interesting. To watch it, click here. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.